Perhaps like you, I enjoy a good TV drama. Based on ratings and reviews, I know I am not alone in watching the TV show Succession on HBO. If you're not familiar with the show, Succession tracks a powerful and wealthy family that runs a conservative media empire, ATN. The patriarch of the family, Logan Roy, dominates the business and the family, but his health is starting to falter, and conflict over his successor is fierce. To give you a feeling for the show, here's a clip of the opening credits and the theme song. Listening to that music, you just know things are not good. Indeed, the show is rife with conflict, betrayal, and greed. So much greed. And while the show certainly is about money and corporate power, I would argue that the deepest motivations and reactions emerge from the dynamics of family. Significantly, the opening credits depict an interplay of golden-hued film clips of the past with brilliant, sharp images of the city and media screens of today. The past informs the present. These decades-old dynamics within the family play out in the conflict for Father Logan's approval and the chance to be named his successor. Episode after episode, we watch as the family history impacts an ever-shifting landscape of which of the four adult children, if any, will be named successor and leader of the future. While our families may not have multi-billion-dollar companies to fight over, I suspect the basic dynamics may not be unfamiliar. Our family histories often have powerful influences on how we live today, as well as how we envision the future. As the first organizations that we belong to, families teach us lessons about how systems work and our roles in systems. Perhaps we learn to be quiet, to avoid conflict, and to keep the peace, even if that meant our emotions became buried. Maybe we learn to value each person having a chance to speak up, to be heard, to be valued as part of the whole. Or maybe we learned that the only way to be heard was to speak more loudly than others in the cacophony of debate. We each carry with us a particular family history that has shaped not only our sense of self, but also how we typically interact in group systems. And while congregations are not families in the same way, there is a school of thought, family systems theory, that explores how our family histories interact with how we show up in congregational life too. Perhaps we bring our avoidance of conflict, our expectations of our voices being heard, or other lessons from family life. Additionally, family systems theory suggests that decades-old group dynamics in a congregation can create their own kind of family system, impacting how people interact with one another. In other words, as in the TV show Succession, our history is shaping our present and thus our path to the future. After reading today's sermon title in the newsletter, one person reached out to me and asked if Succession meant that I was going to announce my departure today. No, I quickly assured the person. But then I started wondering, what if I metaphorically resigned? What if I declared that the ministry I began in 2014 was done, but that now I am starting anew? What if I were just beginning my ministry here? What hopes and visions might I bring? What might be different? In August 2014, I arrived to a congregation still reeling from a period of painful loss. 2 years previously, your minister of 38 years, Ken Sawyer, retired. Around that same time, three precious youth of the congregation died from cancer, a car accident, and a heartbreaking murder. Following these deaths and Ken's retirement, the interim period of 2 years was rocky, and some who left then have never come back. Even so, when I walked in the door in 2014, amidst all the grief, I also felt tremendous love and hope. So many of you had hung in there, had held each other up. So many of you have hung into today, and not just passively hung in, but actively contributed to the vitality of this community through your time, your ideas, and your financial stewardship. Rooted in years of experience and relationships, you have shown up to services, to events, to workdays, in ways that have created and sustained who we are. During these past 8 years, there have also been changes. Yes, even before the pandemic, we created and affirmed a new covenant mission and vision by congregational vote. We voted less formally on a color to repaint the sanctuary. We designed a new logo to represent a vision of a vibrant, sustainable community devoted to service and justice. We deepened our commitment to social justice through the creation of the Lydia Mariah Child Fund and through the many programs it has supported, including the Uganda Project, the Purple Lights for Domestic Violence Awareness, and a kids' social justice library. We also reimagined our children's and youth program as Spiritual and Ethical Exploration for Kids, or SEEK. Kate's job title changed and changed again with this renaming, and when she also took on the work of membership, outreach, and engagement. We have also had to say goodbye to a number of people who moved away or who died, leaving us with poignant memories and sorrow. But we also welcomed many new people who have become beloved, important parts of our congregation. Even in recent weeks, we continue to have new people ask about our community, exploring if this is a place where they too could belong. Some of you will recall that in the winter of 2018-2019, I took a three-month sabbatical. I clearly recall how I returned renewed and with a grounded sense of love for this congregation, for the people, and the place. Nearly a year later, in February 2020, I remember standing in the vestry before a service and delighting in the joyful buzz of people arriving, greeting one another, friends, familiar faces, and strangers. This, I thought, this is the sound of a vital, healthy congregation. And then March came, the shutdown. Difficult weeks became months, became years. And yet I'm still here, And so many of you are still here, even today, snowed in and online. Thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for hanging on. Thank you for not giving up on this community, for not giving up on the idea of this congregation, who we are, and that what we do still matters. But it has been, it is still hard. We miss the ease of physically gathering. We miss people we've not seen online or in person. We miss rummage. Okay, at least some of us do. And I wish I could tell you when it would all be normal again. But we've all pretty much figured out by now that normal is not something we are going back to. Rather, we have been changed. We've been through something that has changed us individually, as a congregation, as a culture. Our future will not be a simple return to the past. Which is why I'm wondering if we should all resign. Resign our past expectations of how we should be as an institution, as participants in the institution. Resign from being wedded to old ways of doing and being that may no longer serve us. Resign from the past in order to recommit to something new for the future. This doesn't mean we forget the past. We are shaped by our past, by our family history, by our congregational history. We are successors of the past and cannot deny that we are shaped by legacies such as a historic meeting house, endowment funds, 75 years of rummage sales, centuries of organ, choral, and hymn singing, and more. As the Reverend Sean Neil Barron writes, the history of your church is the launch pad from which you spring into action or disarray. As such, we are also the congregation of today, who are entrusted with the now of how to be together in this moment, in this context, in this set of questions, circumstances, and group of people. And right now, we are being asked to face questions about our future. What First Parish becomes will be impacted by how we decide now about all matters of issues, from our buildings to our programming, to how we will be with one another, and how we will make space for new people, new ideas, and new ways of being. If I were your new minister today in 2022, I would challenge us to be innovative. A recent multi-faith study of congregations in the U.S. shows that congregations with strong vitality have several things in common. High on that list is an openness to innovation and change. The recent Vision Survey report, which you should have seen in your email this past week, it suggests that many of us are indeed open to innovation and change. In February, we are going to have a chance to talk more about our vision for the future in focus groups. Watch for more information and plan to participate and to encourage others to also participate. Ultimately, what becomes of First Parish in Wayland is largely up to you, to the people who constitute the congregation. As your minister, I literally do not get a vote. However, what I will do is to continue to call us as a congregation to a mission and purpose that is bigger than any one of us. Just as this congregation is bigger and older than any one of us. While the congregation may be constituted by the people, I believe religious communities like ours exist for a purpose, a mission, to make some kind of transformative difference in this world. When I preach from the sanctuary, You may recall that a mere dozen feet or so from the pulpit is a plaque dedicated to the sometime pastors of this congregation. While the plaque does not list all of the ministers who have served the congregation, I take to heart this phrase, sometime pastors. It is a reminder that I am but one minister in a line of succession who have held this role. Someday someone will succeed me, even as I succeeded the Reverend Ken Sawyer, our Minister Emeritus. So also, each of you are sometime members of First Parish. We all come and go, playing our part, bringing who we are, doing what we can to help shape, sustain, and yes, possibly innovate and evolve this congregation. Thank you for being part of this line of succession. Whether this is your first Sunday or your seventh decade as a member, may we continue together into a future that may be uncertain, but is nonetheless the future we are now called to help shape. So may it be. Amen.